then during your tea break, you will look at the cases which we are going to distribute. So first, I will set a backdrop for studying the cases in law or so-called case analysis approach. So what is the backdrop? What's your understanding of doctrinal research? Which are the books you have read on legal research? How many of you are PhD students? Okay, thank you. How many are completed PhD kind of audience members? Okay, there's a small number. Master's students? Very few. Any other? We always keep that any other in
our teachers.
There are teachers who have yet to register for PhD or who are planning to register. Now, what's your understanding of doctrinal research? What is the word doctrinal? What does the word doctrinal mean? Yesterday that discussion would have happened. Mostly doctrinal research is looked at as theoretical research. It is looked at as armchair research based in the library. It is looked at analyzing the concepts, theories, or written print or written material. Nowadays it is accessible through IT or information technology, through the internet or through the databases, through CD-ROMs. Now, that's a basic understanding of doctrinal research. Now, you will understand as we go ahead with case study, case analysis, and content analysis that doctrinal research is not necessarily an armchair research. It can also be out there in the field, and it can also be connected to not only studying theories, but building theories. So that is what I would like to highlight within the limited time, because I am leaving a whole lot of material for you to read. Selected material in the legal context, because I engage in a lot of interdisciplinary research as well. So let us have that idea of doctrinal research on the one side, and let us look at the reality of our discipline. I hope all of you here are lawyers. Yeah, all are legal researchers. Now, if you look at law, law has got a kaleidoscopic appearance. It's a kind of it changes its color according to the context. It wears multiple hats, to use that, you know, multifaceted expression to describe law. Law is a practical discipline set within a professional setting. I mean, who is a lawyer is determined by lawyer's counsel based on certain rules of ethics, certain rules of conduct, certain knowledge, certain values, and certain skills, isn't it? Sometimes it might be too skill focused, and those skills trainings are separately dealt with, or simply training in the law college with along with those little metrics of skills are good enough, as we have in case of India. Or it may be a separate training, as in the case of Law Society qualified lawyer in UK or in the US. So it has a definitely a professional setting. What is a professional setting? A professional is the one who uses the knowledge and skills in service of public, isn't it? So there are certain framework for a professional which is determined by the other professionals. So law is more about peer mentoring as a profession. It's about being accepted by peers, isn't it? So that's it. On the other hand, take it away from that professional setting. Look at it as an abstract discipline. Law is a body of normative rules and principles. You would agree with me. We say normative rules when we refer to bodies of rules like the constitutional law, or the administrative law, contract law, corporate law, so myriad of these bodies. And it is a set of principles. When we talk about principles, we have got the various theories, we have got the jurisprudential dimension that comes to that, with concepts and theories of law. Explaining, trying to explain the normative framework, validate the normative framework, legitimacy and authority of law being explained, efficacy of law being explained. So this is how theories and concepts evolve. So they are either culled out from real life, by observation, or by the working of the scholars, contextualizing it in the existing knowledge. You would agree with me? You understand? Yeah. Now, law as an academic discipline is very much center stage in jurisprudence. Law as a social and political force is reckoned since the time of pre-Socrates days. You know, it wouldn't be called as law then, it would have been called as code of conduct, isn't it? And we would say that in the evolutionary stage, in the status-ridden society also, it was regulating a human behavior. So those were the frameworks, not essentially devoid of the power structures or being entrapped in power. So law per se also needs to be critiqued. So this is how what Dr. Ranbir Singh mentioned earlier, which set a very good stage. in terms of critical thinking, the questioning, eternal questioning. Now, doctrinal legal research per se has been identified by many academic systems. If you look at the front runner in legal academy, the Harvard University, the Dean of Harvard University, then Martha Minow, in one of her addresses in American Association of Law Schools, she distinguishes doctrinal, particularly legal scholarship in the form of doctrinal restatement and recasting. Now, doctrinal restatement is more theoretical aspect. Doctrinal recasting could be a combination of theory and empirical finding. So, let us look at what is doctrinal restatement. And I would request all of you to recall and respond. Organize and reorganize case law into coherent elements, categories, and concepts. Have you read anything in your particular area? One of you can respond. Where doctrinal restatement relation to your specialization area, those of you who are already doctorates, can you recall any study that you have come across which is organizing and reorganizing case law into coherent elements, categories, and concepts? Writing about a series of cases which have been decided by a particular court, we can do it in three ways. In India, I have come across studies. For example, Justice Krishna Iyer's set of judgments with particular reference to labor law. There was a research study conducted as part of the master's thesis in Bangalore National Law School by a student, which was later published as a book. Now, that is organizing and reorganizing case law into coherent elements, categories, and concepts. What is the coherent element there? Isolating those elements. I mean, among so many judgments delivered by Krishna Iyer, you are just sifting or selecting the cases which are dealing with labor law. And then you are breaking them into coherent categories. What kind of theories do they support or reflect? Or they deviate from? They can even deviate from. How the concept of protection of workforce evolves through these case laws and what has been their impact? Right? Have you come across such studies or have you done one study in your doctorate or any publication out of your PhD thesis, whether you have dwelt on any of this? Probably going back from here, you will begin writing in this area or publishing in this area, having drawn these possibilities. Second is acknowledging distinctions between settled and emerging law. If there is a particular area where settled law is talking about something and emerging law, I'll give you the example. It is a settled law that best interest of the child is to be taken into consideration in custodial battles or custodial litigations. Today, there is an increasing tendency in last 5 years with the evolution of children's human rights being recognized of putting the child in the center and interpreting the best interest as inclusive of access to the non-custodial parent. So giving the child access to the non-custodial parent might not be something digestible for a custodial parent because of the differences, because of which such a situation has come of separation. So they use this situation without such knowledge in a biased and hurt manner to deny the access to the other parent. So non-custodial parents' right to access is not to be linked with maintenance, not to be linked with the property claims which might be pending, not to be linked with the heat that they may be undergoing as disputants, but to be focused on child's right to have access to both the parents, because that is psychologically considered as the best option. So bringing the psychological awareness and psychological studies into this, the judges are now acting as custodians of those children, and they are trying to negotiate or force this access to the non-custodial parent. Now, this is where we see settled law and emerging law. Do you see that? Settled law and emerging law. Where is that? Between settled and emerging law. I hope that the example makes it very clear. Identify differences between majority and preferred practices with an explanation of the criteria utilized. What is the majority practice and preferred practice? Today, if I were to subject the ACID test, subject most of the practice, religious practices to the acid test of equality principle within the constitution, I would check. For example, in Maharashtra, we had huge movement. What was that movement on? Entry to women in the Shani temple or in Kolhapur temple. Now that was the difference between majority and preferred practices. Preferred within courts, preferred in our opinion as researchers, based on valid principles of justice and rule of law, equality principle. And the majority practices denial to such places of worship. So how worship is a very private right, it is associated with privacy and denial of that privacy, the relation, one's relationship with God. So many theories and concepts will come into that and you can analyze. Now that was about doctrinal restatement. Now we come here to recasting. Recasting is a vast field. So you gather more than one line of cases across doctrinal fields and show why they belong together or expose unjustified discrepancies and offer a new framework. Today, if you were to look at right to property, the whole trajectory that right to property has traveled through the constitutional cases, or right to property re-emerging in the Land Acquisition Act, if that concept were to travel across a line of cases, is there a resurgence of right to property? Or is there further dilution of right to property? So ask such questions and go through a line of cases. It's not difficult for you at all now with Manupatra, SCC online, keyword searches being provided with the internet. Then, not only that, you will have those categories, those concepts, and those code words identified, and you start collecting these cases, categorize them, try to find a relationship, and try to find a pattern or a trend. You studied that yesterday with the Atlas software, didn't you? Yeah. So that is how you connect it. Similarly, we have the concept of policy analysis. Present a problem, canvas alternatives, propose an evaluative scheme or method, and recommend preferred solutions. Let me show you one example policy. Today in India, we don't have the water law. We do not have the Water Act. Water is not a fundamental right. Although water is recognized as fundamental right in comparative constitutions in South Africa or in Ireland or European Union. Now, Indian water policy, if you see, the water policy is bereft of the idea of tackling the unequal distribution of water because of the large geographically varied landscape that India is. Just connected to the understanding of environmental sciences, the debates on climate change, the literature, vast amount of literature which is coming about depletion of water tables, and then you try to see the water policy and analyze the policy. Water policy has been reviewed many a times, but still the policy does not tackle this idea of, you know, the distribution of water across India. It's an area which is coming under concurrent list. So there is a federal authority, there is also the state authority. So today the water laws are limited to water cess. And water as a natural resource and permanent sovereignty of people over natural resources, the resolution of General Assembly, if you try to apply, whether people of the area are consulted when the water reservoirs of those areas are tapped or they are hired out to industries. We have the very infamous Kerala case where the panchayat had to fight the case of the multinational company. Now, how do you deal with that? Use that case as a window and do the policy analysis. Or go to the problems that people face, or go to these practices of people in dealing with water and connect it to policy. That's what we see as policy analysis. Now, proposition testing. Take a widely assumed or commonly known proposition familiar to legal theorists, undertake an empirical investigation about its validity, summarize, assess empirical work conducted by others, undertake model building, or summarize and apply models developed by others. One of my students tested this approach to 498A in the wake of 2005's Prevention of Domestic Violence Act, you know, the so-called Domestic Violence Act. Someone else tried this Prevention of Sexual Harassment Act, and then she tried to see how harassment per se is an ignored issue, and harassment is not necessarily only on the basis of sexual harassment. So use that, validating it, you create a broader framework. So this analysis she did across the world by opening an online data collection method, and she was able to very clearly posit how workplace harassment is an increasingly annoying phenomenon, and there is a need for developing law to tackle that. So what she is doing is, she is testing a proposition which is existing, that prevention of sexual harassment as a dominant discourse, she is questioning that. We have many other aspects in feminist theory as well. For example, battered woman syndrome, you know, brave and sudden provocation leading to murder, repressed experience of dominance. So once again, psychological theories, mental health issues to be juxtaposed with the law, and those assumptions to be questioned. Because battered women are seen as non-like women, they are seen as sick women, they are seen as women who are murderous by nature. Without inventing, without undertaking an inventory into whether they have lost their mental health because of constantly being under repression. So that is where you test the proposition. Next, study, explain and assess legal institution systems or institutional actors. So we had a very interesting study coming from Daksh in India, which is a non-governmental organization from Bangalore, which did a series of analysis of four high courts judgments and analyze their outcome, and it was able to clearly posit what are the issues which are confronting the legal courts and what could be the ways of improving them. We also had issues of one particular judge's behavior being constantly observed and that being discussed in terms of how that particular judge's number of cases being disposed by that particular judge is very, very slow, because of which the entire court's disposal mechanism gets paralyzed. The amount of time that judge spends and the lengthy elaborative pontification that judge engages in the judicial decision text were very interestingly brought out. Am I making it clear? Yeah. So we can even assess legal institutions, institutional actors in lower courts as well, legal institutions. For example, we did an analysis of justice delivery system in Pune courts, and we realized that they are overburdened, judges are overburdened. And evening courts, which Maharashtra High Court, I mean Mumbai High Court and Maharashtra government decided to implement, were overburdening the judges because they were working in three shifts, and that was not healthy for anybody. So, and then the number of cases were being disposed, but the quality of judgment was another aspect. Then we were also looking at, I mean, I was personally looking into way back in the mid 90s to a series of cases in district court in the wake of dowry violence, where we did a public hearing with a non-governmental organization, and we saw how the judges were strongly biased, and they were seeing they had no empathy, I wouldn't say sympathy, no empathy for these unnatural deaths. They just brushed it under carpet, or they just gave one ubiquitous statement that these girls don't adjust in their in-laws house and they succumb to suicide. Now, we opened one of those cases and we did our own fact-finding, and we came to know that the girl did not succumb to suicide, it was a murder and there was force. So we were able to present it in the public hearing, because of which one of the sitting High Court judges took cognizance of that and allowed a special petition. So the research is not only analyzing institutional actors but leading to action as well, because law and legal research is bound up with justice. Then, conducting historical, anthropological, sociological or economic analysis of behavior of the legal actors or institutions, utilizing empirical or interpretive methods or models, offer a normative assessment or agenda for further strength. We did the analysis of, you know, coal block allocation case, the famous coal block allocation case. And we saw, by analyzing the discourse, it is a method which is doctrinal, where content analysis along with case analysis, with the institutional theory modeling of sociology was analyzed. What were the enabling factors? What were the factors which were mitigating in the decision? Means, what was the contrary view that was, I mean, what was the contradictory factor which was visible in the discourse of the judgment? And what was the factor which was cited as a reason and which could be isolated? So you can do this institutional theory model, or the so-called ISM model, you can utilize it in the graphical way also, where on the x-axis you put the disabling factors or the mitigating factors and the enabling factors on the y-axis, and then the relationship could be plotted. And then we see the one factor, I mean, it is like plotting the variables, the dependent and the independent variable. And when you plot there is one aspect which came out as strongest, which had correlation with all other factors, maximum correlation. You know what that factor was? Conservation of resources. I mean, it is something simple which a doctrinal researcher, a theoretical researcher with inductive reasoning, inductive approach will jump into. But then even in the deductive logic of ISM model, we were able to see the same. I mean, if your analysis is so accurate, what Dr. Singh said about accuracy, you will arrive at precisely the same premise which a very trained critical thinker would arrive at. You got it? So this is how, even with the case law, you can arrive at a normative assessment and interpretive method. I mean, interpretive modeling is what we used. So you can interpret using one particular theory's approach, plot it statistically also, or you can do it qualitatively in a descriptive way also. Now, about economic analysis of the behavior of legal actors, I can give you an example. I heard one great researcher from Penny. She's one of the very good legal researchers. Currently, she is based in Cardiff. Earlier, she was in Northern Ireland in the Queen's University. She spoke about analyzing the Chinese contracts and the contract of the Chinese government in procurement, and she was trying to show how free consent was changing in terms of the elements of the contract. So you take about 20 contracts and you analyze the clauses, and then you connect it to a theory about free consent. In contract, we have so many aspects, you know, there are seven essential elements in a valid contract. So which of the elements is predominant, or which of the elements is vitiated, where is the subtle vitiating of that element, or where there is a visible vitiation. So you can build your own theoretical model, apply it to these kinds of legal transactions, and you can do the economic analysis, or you can do the historical analysis. What could be the example of historical analysis? In India, we have done that. Customary practices, you could do the historical analysis, how they have varied. As lawyers, we don't do like how historians or social scientists do. As lawyers, we do in terms of norm creation, norm compliance, norm deviation, isn't it? So norm becomes the core to us. Or justice as a concept being addressed or not addressed. You know, for example, in tribal justice systems, I was applying this analysis to, I did not publish it, but I was noticing how patriarchy re-emerges with the touch of modernity in tribal communities. We had a primitive community in our place, population of it was about 1,800. It is considered as one of the ancient links to the primitive society, this community. And we were applying the model which Professor Bakshi used in Gujarat, in an NGO which was working with the tribals there. And we were trying to see how the tribal justice system is increasingly becoming trapped with the modern notions and antithetical to the autonomy of women, or it was already there in these practices. I'll give you an example. A woman is accused of adultery. Adultery was never known in these primitive communities. Now this woman is accused of adultery. She is brought before this tribal panchayat, and then the head of the panchayat says that the punishment for her is to serve as the wife of this, or rather sex slave of this head of panchayat. Now, this was not something which was prevalent in the tribal practice, but how personalizing the justice concept has resulted in, which they didn't see, the incoherence or inconsistency they didn't seem to see at that time, because women were never members of the panchayat. So how this panchayat, even if a lot of these writers romanticize tribal justice and tribal way of living as way of equality, For a person who is trained in the concept of patriarchy and equality and gender equality, it was very clear that this was another mode of exploiting the person, and it was running antithetical to the autonomy. So such critical insights, such normative assessment agenda is also part of what we call as recasting, you know, the law or doctrinal research. Critical projects may be exposing the patterns, the results, internally inconsistent structures, just like how I told you, then highlight the tensions, contradictions, and attempt to link them to larger psychological, social, or philosophic difficulties. Can you quote an example? Philosophical difficulties, social difficulties, psychological difficulties.
The issue of natural death, for example.
Very good. Yeah. Anybody else?
Dowry death, for example.
Dowry death.
Then child labor, child marriage.
Child marriage. Very good. So these have very clear example of sociological, social, psychological and philosophical difficulties. You can apply to any disadvantaged section of the society. This example is of gender, this example is of age where children are still not able to form the judgment. You can even apply to the disadvantage to the minority. Clear? Yeah. Because they are not present in the dominant discourse. Or not properly addressed. We have comparative and historical inquiries. What kind of comparative and historical inquiries we can use example as? Inquiries in anthropology or history. Illuminate differences, choices and continuities compared with the contemporary domestic practice. I was giving you one of those examples which could fit in here also. We have the example of the famous, you know, industrial takeover of the tribal gods. Where is this? Orissa, for example.
Vedanta.
Vedanta, yes, very good. So, the Vedanta case is a classic example of interference with the modes of cultural living and cultural approaches, and how they were forced to make choices of coming down from the hill and then leading a modern life. How the transition was not facilitated by the state properly and all those kinds of things. On the other hand, I have a very good example of traveler community in Ireland. When they were shifted from one island which was far away, and the state thought that it is its duty to protect their rights and look after them. So the way they were transitioned and mainstreamed over the years by arranging shipment of these people to the mainland Ireland, and slowly Blasket, this island where they were housed, got emptied. Today Blasket is a tourist center. But the whole process happened very, very slowly in facilitating those people to assimilate those changes. Now, jurisprudence and philosophy, on the other hand, we have very bad examples in the US about how native Indians were treated. I mean, jurists there will tell you the way in which the mainstreaming was very, very invasive. So, invasive mainstreaming can be one area where normative framework of law, the constitutional guarantees, and the philosophical, sociological, anthropological and historical aspects could be reviewed. Now, jurisprudence and philosophy of law. Develop a theory that tries to explain how law or areas of law fit together. Demonstrate contribution this theory makes to the resolution of a doctrinal or practical problem. Advance normative framework for the future. Any jurisprudential theory which does that, can you think of?
Feminist legal theory.
Very good. What kind of advancement it has made? Some of the main areas which we can see where feminist legal theory has influenced is amendment in the rape law, for example, evidence law, custodial rape, evidence law, which is the other project that feminism has taken. Now this sexual harassment in workplace law.
Maintenance,
divorce. Today we are talking about uniform civil code because from the feminist viewpoint, the women who are treated in the same situated in the same situation are treated differently by the law. So this inconsistency in the law or incoherence in the law. So the option of special law or secular law which is available is not catered to because India has also passed reservation to CEDAW's Article 16 and Article 5 as well, which looks at stereotypes. So advancing a normative framework for the future is the Uniform Civil Code or possibility of popularizing the existing secular code as a choice with the people and delinking customary practices from personal entitlements of citizens. Yeah? Now, combinations of the above referenced approaches. An approach can be a combination of all these. It can be a purely doctrinal restatement, theory building, or it can be a practical case study being taken, which could be evolving into a theory or evolving into law reform. As I proceed further, I'll give you more examples. Now, that was the Harvard Dean's exposition of doctrinal research. Let us go to Canada's Arthur's report. It talks about fundamental research in law as a research designed to secure a deeper understanding of law as a social phenomenon, including research on historical, philosophical, linguistic, I'll give you an example of linguistic analysis, economic, social, or practical implications of law. political implications of love. Now, what Martha Minow elaborated is captured in a very simple fashion in this restatement. However, Canada was not just happy with that. So, Canadian Association of Legal Development came out with standards, and these standards are supposed to be most succinct, and they say that doctrinal research is equivalent to discovery in physical sciences. Look at that. That's why this workshop is a very timely idea, because India is really in need of doctrinal research, very serious doctrinal research. We have had many, but your generation should be coming out with the, like our generation together, should be coming out with more and more doctrinal restatement of law, which would put Indian law and Indian legal experience in the global research world. Therefore, to fine-tune it, to develop it, this kind of approach is necessary. Now, they refer to the necessity of students to be able to achieve research methodology skills akin to the doctrinal. Now, that is what CAL says. Now, what are those akin to the doctrinal kind of research skills? One, intellectual and practical skills needed to research and analyze law from primary sources. How to dig out law from the original sources. Apply the findings of such work to the solution of legal problems. Now, this is the kind of research that the court does. Because legal problems are confronted in the court. Legal problems are also confronted in other revenue authorities and others. Whether they have such skills, they do not have. That's why many cases end up in appeals, or there is a growing dissatisfaction on governance. So bringing rule of law to the other authorities also is very important, and that's where we need to popularize these doctrinal research skills. Ability to communicate these findings both orally and in writing. Whether our students are able to communicate these orally and in writing. Moot memorials are a good example. This is what we teach. I think even national law schools, all national law schools across the board teach these skills to the beginner only in the first semester itself. Now, in connection with these two very important expositions on doctrinal research, we have got the Australian exposition, where they say research which provides systematic exposition of rules governing a particular legal category, analyzes relationship between rules, explains areas of difficulty, and predicts future developments. So doctrinal research deals with rules, rules, and rules, and not only just ending with rules, but also talking about how few rules should evolve in future. I'll give you examples as we proceed. For example, all of you, those who have done PhD, would have been urged by your teachers to develop a research problem and investigate that problem with the help of research questions or hypotheses. Then you arrive at your conclusions, which are either answers to these research questions or affirmations or negations of this hypothesis, partially or fully. And then you give recommendations and suggestions. These recommendations are about how to amend the existing law, either inadequacy of the law or absence of law. Inadequacy of the existing law or absence of a law altogether to govern this area. So these flaws you identify and you suggest how to fill those gaps. Now that is exactly what we call as doctrinal research. Now sometimes what happens, relationship between rules also have to be viewed. That is why your guides would have told, have a chapter on comparative dimension. Have a chapter on international aspects. Or have a chapter on constitutionality of the area that you are investigating. How many of you did the constitutionality as a chapter? And that's a sad thing. We go to IPR, we go to all these green research areas, update area. Anybody who has done it? Excellent. So your research was in the area of death penalty, which is a criminal law area, but she has deeply investigated its correlation with the heart of the constitution, namely, now you would say Article 20.
Judicial
discretion. So you looked at the behavior of the courts. Yeah.
I did my research on treaty making power, madam.
Yeah.
For that purpose, like I did the comparative study of the constitutional provisions of India, USA, and Australia.
Excellent. So it is about how this power has been enumerated under the constitution and how it is utilized in practice. Of course, they say there is always a political exigency. Yeah. Now, that's about it. Second is reform-oriented research. Every research in our case, legal researchers' case, is reform-oriented. But there are particular researchers which are directed at reform. Like this death penalty research is a very good example. We also look at reform-oriented research in the Law Commission research. You should read various reports of the Law Commission. I was also urging that when I was a member, that we should look at how many of those reports translated into real legislations. Now, although it is less than 3%, if you go by the past experience of the Law Commission, although it has produced about more than 180 reports, very minuscule of those reports have seen the light of the day in the form of new legislations or amendments. However, through judicial discourses, these reports have been utilized. And slowly from the judicial discourse, you can cull out an element which has formed the essence of the law that you want. You look at Vishakha guidelines. Vishakha guidelines later became OSHA. So like that, we can identify the impact of judicial decisions. So how reform-oriented approaches, either in the judicial discourse or in the policy or in the policy recommendations, evolve into new law to address the new needs of the society. Now, theoretical research. A research which fosters a more complete understanding of conceptual basis of legal principles. We build the conceptual basis of legal principles. Any research anybody has come across, a conceptual framework of any particular, I mean building, validating. Mostly continental Europe engages in this research in a strong way. Even UK and Ireland also research in this line. Americans are mostly into the conceptualization with reference to black letter law. Very few seldom engage in building blocks of legal concepts. Of course, Roscoe Pond was one of them who was showing the law in reality, law in action, and law in text, law in context, and law in text. And then trying to see the basis in sociology, in the social context of law. Realist school also has engaged in this business. So building concepts has been predominantly there in very few researches. Do the judges build the concepts? Yes. How many legal researchers have looked at judges building the concepts? Anybody has come across any article? I'll give you a few articles for you to discuss in groups if we have that kind of time. Now, what is the summary? Doctrinal research, at its best, involves rigorous analysis and creative synthesis. So first you have to synthesize the rule. And while synthesizing the rule, there's a lot of creativity. What Dr. Singh told right now in terms of critical thinking. In critical thinking, there is sometimes, I told you already that doctrinal research is just like discovery. Let us look at the experiences of discovery. Look at Kekulé, the one who said that aromatic substances like benzene are able to create or to be present in multiple compounds in a very mathematically accurate kind of series or chain of compounds because they don't have a linear structure, but they have a ring structure because of which the bonding between elements can change. That's how they become, they can have series of, the C series, C1H2 propylene, C2H4. So like that you have series, methane, then comes the benzene, C6H6. So how could this manifest was the question of Kekulé. And in the night, he gets the dream of snake catching its own tail. And he derives this idea of ring structure, hexagonal ring structure in benzene, because there are six elements there of carbon, six molecules. So that accounting for the aromatic nature, and today it has evolved into so many things like polythene, the petroleum products, the refinery industry. See, one foundational research leading to so many developments. Now, if you are looking at creative synthesis of isolating that law, if that is already present in the statute, all right. If not, you synthesize it from the existing substratum of raw material of law, like how Kekulé synthesized it from the carbon compounds. Right to, Article 21. Of course, now it has been going beyond its stretchability. But then it has also given sacrosanct nature to something like right to education, right to health, which are also considered as part of human development indices, isn't it? And thereby they cater to the human development aspiration of justice. So, theoretically connecting, justice is not just a laundry list of this is justice, that is justice. Justice is an ever-evolving concept. So, this is where you see that there is a need for a creative break It is called deductive leap in thinking. So who first started that mischief of using Article 21 to read those unenumerated rights into the enumerated, limited vocabulary of Article 21? You know, unenumerated dimension came from many other best practices of other constitutions of Commonwealth countries like us. And unenumerated rights being drawn from directive principles of state policy was prevalent in those countries where directive principles of state policy was present. I'm just giving you as an example, not to exhibit the knowledge of constitutional law. The very notion of legal reasoning here is very subtle. It's a very sophisticated jurisprudential concept, a unique blend of deduction and induction at the same time. You have to be a Kekule, and you have to be a very creative interpreter, extremely masterly command over the language of constitution to evolve such principles. A unique blend of deduction and induction. It has engaged legal scholars for generations. It's a key to understanding the mystic of legal system's simultaneous achievement of constancy and change. You can't make law too flexible and diluted so that there is a chaos in the society. But law can be too rigid not to accommodate the changes which have been ushered in by the media, by the technology, by the interface of economic forces, you know, social forces, by the demographic changes in the society, isn't it? For example, I was analyzing the discourse of the Supreme Court on obscenity cases. When the Anand Patwardhan's documentary, what is that? Father, Son and... it is actually on... It is basically about how the patriarchy transformed into... matriarchy transformed into patriarchy, and then later on the violence became commonplace. He is tracing that in his documentary. This was the most controversial documentary. He was trying to connect it to the Hindutva violence and also Punjab violence, etc. So that was questioned because he had many nude images of women being used there as one of the historical evidences of matriarchy being present in the society, you know, the nurturing attitude being predominant, leading to the fighting attitude, competitiveness. So when this holy, Father, Son and Holy War, this is the name of the documentary. So this was being questioned in the Supreme Court. Till then, Supreme Court never talked about shifting stands of morality in society to be accommodated. You know, shifting stands of morality in society as a discursive practice within the Supreme Court judgment is a very, very important indicator of changing demography of the society. And looking at the young minds and looking at curiosity in the population being addressed through such documentaries, and also reading it into the freedom of speech and expression as right to know, right to be informed, you know. So this shows that how there is a legal system simultaneously achieves consistency, constancy, being constant and change. Anyone has read Wolfgang Friedman's book on law and social change? Yeah, he talks about principal antinomies of law, the contradictions within the law. Stability and change is one of the principal antinomy relationship. They have to be so present that law doesn't change, but it remains constant, but accommodates those changes and allows the society to be very stable. So that's it. So doctrinal research can scarcely be quarantined. You can't quarantine legal research from broader theoretical and institutional questions. You can't say law is to be found only in law books. Black letter law research is a way of quarantining doctrinal research. You can't quarantine. You have to make it to be vibrant. You have to make it to be dynamic. So that's about the understanding of doctrinal research. Any question? I think we have interacted enough. Everybody has, I hope everybody has in mind some example, some familiar chord is struck in terms of what you have read, what you have written. Am I right? Yeah. So now let us move to this exercise in case analysis. I hope he got the offerings. No, he brought it, I think, or print. He has given it for printing. So once he gives it, I'll engage you in the exercise during tea break. I mean, already we are ahead of tea break. So 5 minutes, I'll just explain. There is a method called IRAC method, I-R-A-C method. This method was evolved in the practice of Christopher Landel, first proposed this method in the Harvard University. IRAC method principally in the word I, in the acronym I, alphabet I, we encapsulate issues. What are issues? If you go back to your understanding of civil procedure code, issues are the fundamental questions which are evolving out of the court. Issue can be a question of fact or a question of law or a mixed question of fact and law. You know that. The contentious aspect in a legal case. Now, so it covers, I covers issues, R covers rules, A covers application of rules to those set of issues which we have identified, and C covers conclusion. What is the conclusion of the court? What has the court decided? So in the conclusion, you can have two parts. One is the holding. Holding is answer to the issue. For example, both me and she are fighting that this property is mine. I am saying this is mine, she is saying it is hers. So whether, I mean, I am contesting before the court, I am the plaintiff. Whether S is the owner of that property. So whether S is the owner of that property has to be verified, not only from my plaint, but also from my documents, isn't it? So it is a question of fact. Now, the nature of the document within the existing rule of ownership under the Property Act, whether that document is talking about me purchasing full rights or me inheriting that right by way of gift, I mean by way of legacy, or me getting, being a transferee of that right, which was a donation from somebody, gift from somebody, am I a donee? Or is it that I have come here and occupied, like how many people have done, you know, illegal occupant of this land, and I have tried to regularize it by applying to the government or to the original owner, and then I am trying to negotiate my right. But possession is 9 points of law under jurisprudence, a concept, jurisprudential concept. So I am asserting that right, let us say. Or I am the real owner, I am not on site, she is the one who is occupying that land and she is saying she is the owner. So I am applying to the court for a declaratory relief that I am the owner, and based on that I want, and also injunction to discontinue her from ownership, I mean possession. And her possession is only 2 years old, not 30 years. Okay. If it is more than 30 years, then maybe I don't have a valid claim in law, so I will have to ask her to negotiate this outside the court to settle the dispute. So there are many ways by which the issues emerge. Facts are seen. So we have to see those facts in the light of the rule. The rule, Transfer Property Act, clearly says the ownership can accrue in these ways. But if it is only possession, then that can be equivalent ownership if it fulfills these facts. So, based on my plaint, as a judge, you will see if my plaint and my evidences are indicative of fulfilling those rules. So, as a judge, when you decide, you say that I am the owner. Therefore, I should be continued. I should not be dispossessed. My possession, my ownership should not be interrupted. That is your holding. So, the issue is whether I am the owner. The holding is, yes, I am the owner. Therefore, you know. Why? Then the ratio. Why? Because as per this rule and based on these facts, this person is the owner. So that why question, with the help of the rule, when it is answered, that is ratio. And then there are other observations about contradicting factors, negating factors, about the flaw in the rule itself, limitation in the rule itself. Those are observations made by the way. Those are called obiter dicta. So in a decision, we have to analyze both the holding ratio and the third factor of obiter dicta. Have you done that analysis? Okay. So we will give you an exercise during tea time. So here it is very important to read the statute as well. I think already Dr. Bajpai yesterday, he said that he has given you an exercise on reading the statute. How do you read a legislation? We call this as anatomy of law. A case law, how you break it into its head, holding, conclusion. How you break it into its arm, how you break it into its leg, how it walks, how the law evolves, you know. So that is anatomy in terms of case law. And once again, the rule also has to be further dissected. Within the rule, you have to see the key portion of the rule. You know, we have the idea of remedy that it wants to advance, malady that it wants to suppress, the conditionalities which are there. So a rule also can be split into or subsplit into parts. But when we subsplit the rule into parts, we do it with reference to the facts which come before us. So that is what we call as the mixed questions of law and fact. When you arrive at a conclusion, that conclusion has to be very neatly justified. Wherever the judges have not done it, it is an erroneous decision. For example, I came across a decision of one of the senior Supreme Court judges. He is now decorating some other position with the kind of clout he must be having. This judge gave a decision once on a little child, a young child, who was separated from the father for very long, and then made the mother to travel all the way with the child and forced the child to go to the father, and told the father to hug the child and told the child that you have been, which normally happens as well, judge is not wrong in assuming that, that you have been tutored not to look at your father. I mean, the child is just 6 years old. And this creates a trauma to the child, and the child becomes very isolated, he becomes very quiet, and then he was referred to the mental hospital. And in the mental hospital, they prescribe drugs to the child. Now, even a small dose of drug is good enough to send the child to a berserk state of brain processes, etc. So social workers and NGOs and family advisors intervene, and the judges are simply there to do justice because they are told that child's rights are important. Can the right be independent of the holder of the right? Now that's where reading neatly the rule is very important, and having all other considerations in terms of the bearer of the right also is very important. And those psychological opinions where judges were not willing to look into, that's also wrong, because you might be a judge but you are not an expert in understanding the holder of the right or the situation or mixed situation of the right. So reading the case is one anatomy of law. IRAC is the way to break it. Statute reading is two ways. One is the formal reading, where you see what is the objective of the statute. See, many judges would not have any found any support in the particular rule segment of the statute, but then they would have recourse to the objective, just like how in constitution preamble is the key to open the minds of the makers of the constitution. Objective in a statute, the purpose, the short clauses, the commencement clauses, the validity clauses, they give an indication. Definitions give an indication. Overall reading of the statute, if you see the way in which the rights are defined, the way in which the protection mechanisms, this is all there in the statute. A statute can be easily understood in terms of the rights it defines, in terms of the rights it reinforces, in terms of the rights it amends, in terms of the rights it adds, enhances, in terms of the authorities who have the powers, in terms of the rules which will facilitate the operation of the statute. Do you agree that this is all there in the statute? And then the remedy it may want to advance, the malady it may want to suppress. Go back to your study of interpretation of statutes, you know. So this is how you connect your understanding here when you read the rules. Many times judges have gone into the historical development of the statute, just like how Constituent Assembly debates have been had recourse to while understanding articles of the Constitution or interpreting the Constitution. Now you read this case, read the rules which are stated in the case itself. We don't have that kind of time available to us, and write a short analysis in your group. We can divide the whole class into three groups maybe. So, now this is the story, this is a sample case analysis. You know this animal koala, this story was given to me from one of our instructors, Tonya, from United States of America. She's a very accomplished clinical legal teacher. So she is invited to our institute and students learn under her guidance this exercise. So when she is not able to come, sometimes I do, or other American teachers who come use these materials and they do. And then we try to teach them how to prepare moot memorials, case analysis, etc. So in Australia, Koala Care is an organization which owns a koala rescue, because koala is an endangered species. And then it has just rescued an injured koala from some hunters. Koala was friendly and would eat from a person's hand. What does it mean? It became friendly and it would eat from a person's hand because it was brought to the rescue organization and it was a pet. So there is a difference between, see, the wild koala, where found in the forest, the koala is property of everybody. But when it is domesticated and pet, the very definition of pet is domesticated. See how attentive you have to be when you read a fact. Okay, and then client had the koala in the care only since 3 days before it escaped. See the duration of time. So on both sides, if you are applying your mind as the plaintiff and the defendant, how each of those facts can be in your favor or against you. So when you are presenting your case, it is not only the facts in your favor that you have to select and highlight, you have to also do the counter analysis of the facts which are not favorable to you. Sometimes lawyers suppress those facts, but sometimes they do a denial. We call it as rebuttal, isn't it, in evidence law. So a citizen captured a koala and gave it to a private zoo. Who owns a koala? Zoo or rescue organization? Okay. Now comes what type of tort claim does Koala Care have, the organization have? That is the issue. What kind? Now, common law tort of reclaiming, that is, reclaiming a property which has been lost and converted by someone else. This was converted, isn't it? The person who found it in the forest converts it into a wild animal and then gives it to the zoo. The zoo is now converting it as its own property without finding out the rightful owner because it believes that the person captured it from the wild. Res communis, you know, something which is of community. Nobody is the owner, everybody has access. But if someone tries to be an owner, uses it, right to use is there. So that is how the person commits no crime by procuring it from the forest and giving it to the zoo. A rightful owner of unique and identifiable personal property is entitled to its return, reclaiming is that return, from the one who has wrongfully taken possession. Now the word wrongful possession will have to be read in counter analysis as what is rightful possession then, isn't it? Or in civil cases usually, tort is a civil case, we usually decide, we have to decide which is a better right. Clear? So we can use this case from two points. One is to write an analysis as a researcher. The other is to argue your case. Either of the two you can do with the same case. Now exercises break the rule into parts. I told you rule has to be anatomized. Who is the person entitled to legal relief? Who? Koala Care. Then we say whether. That is the issue. Okay. Second, who is the wrongdoer? Whether this guy, zoo is the wrongdoer or the guy who caught it and gave it to the zoo. What is the subject of dispute? Very simple answer. What action must be taken and by whom? Who has to take the action? What is the remedy? In civil cases, we always talk about what is the remedy.